and have your Bibles with you, we'd ask you to turn to the book of Numbers. Numbers chapter 22, and we're going to begin reading in verse 21. Numbers chapter 22, and we're going to begin reading in verse 21. The Bible says, "And Balaam rose up in the morning and saddled his ass and went with the princes of Moab. And God's anger was kindled because he went. And the angel of the Lord stood in the way for an adversary against him. Now he was riding upon his ass, and his two servants were with him. And the ass saw the angel of the Lord standing in the way, and his sword drawn in his hand. And the ass turned aside out of the way and went into the field. And Balaam smote the ass to turn her into the way. But the angel of the Lord stood in the path of the vineyards, a wall being on this side and a wall on that side. And when the ass saw the angel of the Lord, she thrust herself into the wall and crushed Balaam's foot against the wall, and he smote her again. And the angel of the Lord went further and stood in a narrow place where there was no way to turn either to the right hand or the left. And when the ass saw the angel of the Lord, she fell down under Balaam, and Balaam's anger was kindled, and he smote the ass with a staff. And the Lord opened the mouth of the ass, and she said unto Balaam, What have I done unto thee that thou hast smitten me these three times? And Balaam said unto the ass, Because thou hast mocked me. I would that there were a sword in my hand, for now I would kill thee. And the ass said unto Balaam, Am not I thine ass, upon which thou hast ridden ever since I was thine unto this day? Was I ever wont to do so unto thee? And he said, Nay. And the Lord opened the eyes of Balaam, and he saw the angel of the Lord standing in the way, and his sword drawn in his hand, and he bowed down his head and fell flat on his face." I'd like to preach, the Lord be my helper tonight, on the thought, you can do it the easy way, or you can do it the hard way. Amen. Dear Lord, we thank you for your goodness and watch care. Lord, we thank you for your mercy and grace on this place. Lord, we thank you for a nice place to meet, Lord. We praise you for that. Lord, we pray for other like-minded churches tonight that are meeting to honor you and to lift you up and to sing praises to thy name. Lord, we pray that we might be in unison tonight and that we would lift you up as well. Lord God, we pray that you would bless your word, Lord, that you'd use it to humble the hard-hearted, Lord, and that you would encourage the soft-hearted, even where they're at tonight. Lord, we pray it in thy name. Amen. Now, fairly familiar verses of Scripture. Sometimes I think we miss the real meaning of it, but one thing is for sure, if we believe God's sovereign, and I do, His will be accomplished. It will be accomplished one way or the other. Now, the sad truth is this, for hard-headed mankind, it's usually the hard way. It is usually the way of most difficulty, and the reason why is because many times we think we know more than God. We think that we have an advantage over God. Listen, two things about God. He's not sitting around hoping that you might do something. He accomplishes what He will with what He wants. Secondly, He's not wringing His hand hoping that you make some kind of decision to follow Him. That is not the God of the Bible. Now, that's the God that sold today, but it is not the God of the Bible. And the reason why God is sold on that and reduced to nothing is because if we see God as He truly is, then we're completely dependent on Him. And that is not a popular thing in the day which we live. Verse 21, "And Balaam rose up in the morning and saddled his ass and went with the princes of Moab." Now, I want you to notice two things. If you know your Bible, just previous here, he had got a message that he had to deliver, which had some scathing news for those people. You know, the hardest thing that you'll ever do is deliver a message of bad news. Now, it can be preaching of the Lord Jesus Christ. It can be preaching His Word. Or if you ever have to convey to someone that their mother did not make it, that she died in transport, it may be hard news. And Balaam's news was hard. And it was so hard, he wouldn't share it. Now that is where we're at today. Most people, if they have a hard message, they want to soften it somehow to fit the day which we live. Really, if you get right down to it, that's the issue with dress today. And people don't want to stand for it. And people criticize that preaches it. But the real thing is this, it's been compromised down. It's become offensive to most. That ought not to be among God's people. And so we see then in this day that Balaam had a hard message and he refused to deliver it. And in addition to that, I want you to see who he was hanging out with was the princes of Moab. You know what? Young people, you listen to me. Be very cautious of who you hang out with. And you don't have to be going out among people with that. You know what? You can hang out with people right here. You be cautious of who you're texting on this device. You be cautious who you're Facebooking. You be cautious with this device in my hands, because you can be going places and doing things that otherwise you would not do. So Balaam was in a mess. He did not want to be faithful to the Word of God. And he was hanging with some people he had no business to be hanging around with. Verse 22. And God's anger was kindled because he went. Now that I could preach all night right there. Yeah. God's anger was kindled because he went. You know what? You can be saved and sound as a dollar and God be angry at you. Have you ever thought about that? It's very, very true. You can be saved and God's anger kindled against you. I don't know about you, but that makes me shake in my boots. And every time you find out through the Word of God that happened, it was always because of disobedience. It was always because of rebellion. And we, as the Lord's people, we need to be aware of those elements in our life. And when they begin to raise up and they begin to show themselves for what they are, we're going to be able to try to cower them down the best that we could. So he went without God's plan. He went against God's plan. And the anger of the Lord was kindled against him. And the angel of the Lord stood in the way for an adversary against him. Now listen, he was going, and he wasn't supposed to go. He was supposed to say, I'm not going with you. This is not a good thing. You're going to end up beat and be good. And he would not say it. And so, the Lord God put an angel in front of him. You know what? If God says stop, best thing you can do is stop. And if God says go, the best thing you can do is go with everything that you got. And we live in a day and age where that's minimized. And I will say this, sometimes we're more guilty of saying, of being in a situation where God said went and we didn't go, than going and he says stop. But Balaam had no reason to be where he was at, so God stood in the way. The rest of verse 22, now he was riding upon his ass, and two servants were with him. And the ass saw the angel of the Lord standing in the way, and his sword drawn in his hand. And the ass turned aside out of the way and went into the field. And Balaam smote the ass to turn her into the way. Now Balaam was determined to do things his way. And I see that more and more in people today. It's going to be their way or the highway. So the ass saw the angel. She turned this way. And he beat her back around until she was heading forward again. Listen, we don't need to force things. You know what I found? If God's in it, he'll open the door. So he just beat her and forced her back in the direction that he wanted to go. Where he would look good. Where he thought he ought to be. You know what? You need to be very cautious about that. You need to be very cautious about making snap decisions on a basis where there's no spirituality to it. You're making it just with your flesh. Verse 24, and the angel of the Lord stood in the path of the vineyards, a wall being on this side and a wall on that side. And when the ass saw the angel of the Lord, she thrust herself into the wall and crushed Balaam's foot against the wall. Now, I want you to get the full gist of this, because he had a wall going this way. Have you ever been in a hallway or a real close place? And really, if there's something obstructing you, the only thing you can do is turn around and go the other way. Now, that was God's plan for Balaam's life, was to turn around and head back the other way. But he thought he knew more than God. And you say, oh, I wouldn't. Yes, you have. You've been in that situation too. Don't get down on Balaam. And so we see then what the ash does this time. She crushes that foot between the wall and herself. Now, I have to believe the Bible just like it says, right? And to me, a crushed foot, you know what that means? It means a crushed foot. And the bones in the foot are very small anyway. And when they get crushed, you know what? They don't go back together like they used to be. It is very hard. In the modern day, it takes surgery to set a foot back like it's supposed to. In that day, there was no such thing. So one thing that I would have to come from this is Balaam was a cripple the rest of his life. You know what? We have things in our life that we take to grave with us that could have well been avoided if we just followed God's plan. It well could have been avoided if we would have followed what the Lord would have us to do and not what we would ourselves would enjoy doing. And so we see now that Balaam is so determined it's going to be his way and he's going to get the job done, that now in addition to being mean to his donkey, now he's got health problems on top of it. You know what? I dare say a lot of health problems could be avoided if we would just simply follow the will of God. Now I want you to see in verse 26, and the angel of the Lord went further. Now, this is a merciful and gracious God, and at the same time, He will accomplish His purpose. He always has, He always will. Now, number one, Balaam was getting punished again. And number two, He was going to stop. If God wants you to stop, you know what? Ultimately, you'll stop. And on top of that, if God wants you to go, ultimately, you will go. You may go screaming and kicking every step of the way, but I guarantee you, if God wants you to go, you will go. Anything less than that is not a sovereign God, right? And so we see then that Balaam thought that he knew more than God. He thought his agenda was better than God's. And so we see again that the Lord God sends an angel to stand in his path. And the angel went further and stood in a narrow place. And there was no way to turn either to the right hand or the left. And when the ass saw the angel of the Lord, she fell down under Balaam. And Balaam's anger was kindled, and he smote the ass with a staff. Now, I want you to get the full understanding of that, because now they're blocked in and she just goes down like this. She was not going to oppose God. Isn't it a strange thing? Sometimes animals and the world about us understand God better than we do. You know, the planets and the stars keep their root because God says so. They have more understanding than the Creator, than even that we do. And so we see then that as the ass gives way under her and just says, I'm not going to do it. And then we have this donkey or this ass preach a sermon to Balaam himself. Isn't it an amazing thing what things will preach to you sometime? It doesn't have to be a person like me preaching the glorious gospel of Christ. I've been going down the road and see some things and say, you know, God sent that my way. Sometimes you have a little problem with your car, and you pull off, and you look, and you know, what is going on here? You get frustrated, and then you get back in the car and go about 2 miles, and you find an accident. You know what? That could have been you if God hadn't intervened. If he's sovereign, he's sovereign, right? He can't be a little bit sovereign and be sovereign sometimes and other times not be sovereign. He has to be completely sovereign. And so the ass and Balaam have a discussion. Then the wonderful thing in verse 31, and the Lord opened the eyes of Balaam, and he saw the angel of the Lord standing in the way, and his sword drawn in his hand, and he bowed down his head and fell flat on his face. Now, that is getting right with the Lord. Now, I'll say this, his eyes had to be opened. And you know what? When you come into line with God and understand your situation, whether you're in rebellion to His plan for your life, or whether you're lost and you need a Savior, or whether you're simply not where you need to be spiritually, it is always an act of God that makes that real to you. This flesh can't reason that stuff out because they're spiritually discerned. That's what Paul told the church at Rome. He says these things are spiritually discerned. And so we see then the Lord used, and I want you to see that this angel had a sword in his hand. Now, I have to believe that angels still have swords, do you not? Why would this angel be any different than any other angel? So sometimes we have to be pointed in the right direction. Now, if you know this story, Balaam did deliver the original message. He was faithful to what God said. And you know what I say to that? He's sovereign, and his message always comes through. Now, unfortunately, most of us are good graduates of the Balaam school of following God, and we do it the same way Balaam did it, and we have to get knocked about a bit, have to go around. Another individual, if you go with me to the book of Jonah, very familiar, and again, I use these two examples because there's much more examples of those that did not follow God appropriately than those that did. Many, many more stand into rebellion of His plan. Jonah chapter 1 in the very first verse. And the word of the Lord came unto Jonah the son of Amittai, saying, Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry against it, for their wickedness is come up before me. Now, I'll give you two things concerning Jonah. Number one, he's no different than you and I. And number two, he didn't like Nineveh. Number three, he lacked love. He lacked love. Because had he been a loving individual, he would have been glad to go down to Nineveh and preach the glorious gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. If he had loved mankind even, he would have been glad to go and preach what the Lord had him to preach. But he did not have a love for people. You know what? I see that as an alarming thing today. Is people don't love one another anymore. And I'm not talking about the world at large. I'm talking about God's people to God's people. They don't love one another anymore. That ought not to be named among God's people, but it is. And if we'd be honest, we would have to say, yay, Lord, that's true. Certainly that is the situation which we live. And so we find that Jonah did not want to carry out. But Jonah rose up to flee unto Tarshish from the presence of the Lord and went down to Joppa, and he found a ship going to Tarshish, so he paid the fare thereof and went down unto it to go with them unto Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. Now, I want you to notice two things. First of all, God can leave you, but you can't leave God. Now, God will withdraw Himself. I'm not talking about being lost again. But every one of us knows the coldness to set away from the Lord that you love. Be honest, right? He can withdraw Himself from you And not only can he does in regards to sin. Now, the other thing is this. We find that he makes an attempt at something that can't be done, and that is running from God. If God wants you to do something, he's going to bear witness to that. If God wants you to do something, you will accomplish it, and it can be the easy way or it can be the hard way. Now, more times than not, because we're stupid and we think we're bigger than God and we think we know more than God, we have to go the hard way. We get the good school of hard knocks. We get to go through the difficult times. And the reason why is we don't follow him to start with. Now, you certainly know the rest of the story. He gets into that ship to go to Joppa, and the Lord sends something to stop his way. Now, what he does is he sends a storm to attack the ship. You know what? Not even a distant bolt of thunder, a distant rumble of thunder is outside God's dominion. If you hear that far away, and that's as close as it ever gets, you know what? God wanted it that way. He wanted it that way. And so we find that this huge storm comes up, and what is the natural response? Rolling. They fought. You know what? It is a stupid thing to fight against the will of God, but we do. And they're rolling against the storm, and then they get him up and say, Jonah, what are you doing? And they finally decide that he's the problem. They cast their lots. They fall on Jonah. And Jonah finally is honest with them, and he said, here's God's plan. Throw me over. And then what did they say? No. And you know why? You know what happened when they said no? The storm got worse. And you know what? When you say no, the storm's going to get worse. And you know what? Those poor mariners had no idea of what was going on. They had no idea even who God was. They didn't even know what God was. And they were suffering at the hands of God because of one man. Have you ever thought what you have caused New Testament church just because of you?
Right.
On the flip side, praise be the Lord, have you ever thought about what New Testament enjoyed? Just because of you. Now I hope the second is more frequent than the first. But every one of us have come cold and indifferent at times. And when you do that, and when I do that as your pastor, I'm putting you subject to things that ought not to be. And so we as the Lord's people need to certainly realize, first of all, we're not the only one on the ship. Then lastly, we know they finally listen to Jonah, and they throw Jonah over the side of the ship. He's swallowed up by a fish, a great fish, and he stays down there for 3 days. And you know what? By the time he came up, he was ready to do what God had told him to do. So we find the things involved was a storm, a group of men that didn't know God, and a fish that was in the bottom of the sea. All those accomplishing the will of God. Think about how much easier it would have been if he just walked over to Joppa and said, you know what? Repent. That was the only message he had, was to repent. And you know what? It seems oh so easy. But what God in his goodness today said, Brother Ashley, I want you to go into the house of the Senate and just simply say repent. A lot easier to talk about it than it is to do, is it not? A lot easier to criticize Jonah than to put yourself in Jonah's position. And so then we as the Lord's people, we need to understand and we need to know and we need to embrace when God gives us something to do, we don't need to do it the hard way. You know what? God's will be accomplished because he's sovereign and he's holy and he's mighty and he's above all things. And it will be accomplished. But why do we have to do it the hard way? But we do. The book of Genesis chapter 5. We see the exception to the rule. very, very godly man. Genesis chapter 5, verse 18. The Bible says, "And Jared lived 162 years, and he begat Enoch. And Jared lived after he begat Enoch 800 years, and begat sons and daughters. And all the days of Jared were 962 years, and he died. And Enoch lived 65 years, and begat Methuselah. And Enoch walked after God, and Enoch walked with God after that he begat Methuselah 300 years, and begat sons and daughters. And all the days of Enoch were 365 years, and Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him." Now that's the easy way. That's the way to be found in the will of God. That, you know what, I fully believe that he walked with God all the days of his life. If God says you go that way, Enoch took off this way. And he says, "No, turn around, go back the other way." Enoch took and went off this way. He was a man that followed God. That's what we ought to strive to be. People that do not question. You know, people that say what and if. What if and but. Those are words that will stifle your faith. They will stamp your faith out. What if and but. We ought to get in our minds, "Yay, Lord. Yay, Lord. I'm just going to do it. Do I know what's going to happen? But I do know if I trust him, whatever happens, and I don't like to be beat up."
That's right.
I was a little scrawny kid coming up. Got beat up a whole lot. I don't like to get beat up. Kind of like eventually kind of one of those kids, "If you want my lunch money, there it is." You know what I'm saying? That's the best way that we ought to be. If God says it, do it. And then let the chips fall where they may. We ought to be after the Lord in that way.